Thank you for joining Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and we will take you inside the auto industry like never before. And when I say we, I mean me and my very knowledgeable and today very good-looking panelists sitting in the film strip below. And today we have something special for you. We're going to launch a brand new segment called Spotlight. We have a very special guest that's going to talk about the wheels that you roll on when you're driving that brand new or used car. But before we get into that, let me introduce a new product that we have. It's called Auto Network Wi-Fi. Ooh, it's kind of washed out in that bright light there. But that's it's a Wi-Fi service that allows businesses to get more mobile sales. Now that that's out of the way, I will have the regular panelists introduce themselves.
Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt.
Somebody has the show on their computer. Would you please turn that off? I know that it's nice that you want to see and hear yourself, but don't do that.
I'm very knowledgeable and today very.
Who's playing it? Oh, there we go. As I was saying, let's have the journalists introduce themselves, starting with Steve. Well, since Steve is new, we'll let Steve go next. Linda.
Hi, I'm Linda Sharp, and I'm coming to you from the beautiful Blue Ridge Mountains of North Carolina, just a stone's throw from Mayberry, USA. I've been in the automotive journalism business for about 20 years. Prior to that, I raced sports cars for about 20 years. Obviously, I've been doing this a long time. I have a website, sharpdriver.com. I invite you to explore my new car reviews and to look at some very amusing vintage photographs of early sports car racing. Excited to be here, excited to talk tires, because there is no more important part of a vehicle than the part that connects it to the road. So I'm really pleased that we're having Kurt here today. So welcome.
Pleasure to be here.
Greg.
Hi, I'm Greg Morrison. I'm executive producer of Bumper to Bumper TV, coming to you from Atlanta, Georgia. We do a weekly video review of new cars and new car products. And again, I'm like Linda, I'm thrilled to talk with Kurt and Heather about tires and, you know, what people drive. But Linda, I only have one question. Since you live close to Mayberry, do you ever get a chance to see Ernest T. Bass?
No, you know, the closest we have some bronze statuary of Andy and Opie, but they wouldn't let us put one up of Barney. CBS objected to that. So we don't have Ernest T. Bass either.
And we have a new journalist joining us in the panel today, and that's Steve. Steve, tell us a little bit about who you are and where you are and what you do. Well, Steve didn't want to stay. He left. Hey, we had that to happen with Mary, who was a new panelist. She didn't come back either. But anyway, moving right along. Let's get a little in the news. Audi to pass Cadillac in sales. Do you think it's going to happen, Linda, Greg?
Yes.
Yes.
Why? Yes.
They're building phenomenal cars. And they've got a whole suite of luxury offerings that, as we've said before, Audi's stealing everybody's marbles on the playground. It was just a matter of time. Cadillac knows this, which is why Johan is there trying to get them energized and hopefully come up with some strong product that people will gravitate to. But there's no American supercar right now.
I think that Audi has somehow managed to create this phenomenal panache about a large luxury sedan. Plus, they offer you some of the very best powertrains in the industry, you know, a full range from turbos to diesels. Did I say diesel? Diesel?
Yeah, you said diesel.
And, you know, it's they as Greg said, they build a phenomenal product, and that's not to diminish the Cadillac product right now, but they're the new kid on the block, you know. They have a new image, a new aura about them, and I think, you know, like early adopters run in and gravitate to new technology, I think that a lot of buyers are gravitating to a new technology or a new brand, if you will, when they're searching out the luxury segment.
Well, it's interesting that neither one of them are in the race for number one in the luxury segment. It's neck and neck between BMW and Mercedes. I think last week when I took some notes, BMW was in the lead. Today when I went and checked the stats, Mercedes is in the lead. So they're really close. Steve is back. Steve, can you hear me? No, I can't hear you. Here we go again. Okay, Steve, you can say something later. Anyway,
that's here we now.
There we go. Who you are? Tell us quickly.
What is going on?
Who
with
you
this
are and where you
technology?
Are? Come on, Steve. Say who you are and where you are. You're holding up the show.
Let me unmute everybody. Hold on.
You don't have to unmute everybody. We can. We'll take care of that. Who you are, where you
this
are.
This is annoying.
Who you are, where you are. Anyway, moving right along. Let's get into some recalls. Nissan's calling 47,000 vehicles for possible fuel leaks. Steve, mute yourself. Thank you.
No.
Mute yourself.
I'm here now.
Steve Seiler, here we go. Mute, yes. Look at that. I can do that. Steve's gone. Okay, 470,000 vehicles. Nissan's being recalled, the 2012 through 2015 models, for possible fuel leaks. Anybody hear about that?
I haven't checked the recall, but everyone's being super cautious, even small stuff, and this is nothing small if you get a fuel leak.
Well, I think Greg's right. I think everybody is being preemptive on this, that, you know, they're just trying to cover their rear end and make sure that if anything happens, they're not facing liabilities. But I also wonder if, you know, it's like, well, we need to get people into our service department, too, because anybody that goes in for a recall typically spends a little bit of extra coins in there when they are having the recall done. So a side effect of these recalls is that it can generate revenue for the service department at the dealership. So I'm not saying that they are doing this for that reason, but I think it maybe makes it less hesitant to issue the recall. You know, when they weigh it, should we or shouldn't we, I think that the fact that it can help the bottom line for some dealers probably is a little added incentive.
Well, it's helping them in sales. It's helping them, as you just said, Linda, in service. So the recalls haven't been a bad thing, and I think some of the manufacturers are taking advantage of that, even though they don't have big recalls. And, you know, like, who is it? Somebody's out there, I forgot who it is, only has a 7,000 car recall. So if I'm only going to recall 7,000 cars, I don't think I'll put that out in the media. But I think they're putting it out in the media to get people to come in and, like you just said, maybe sell them another car or get them to spend more in the service area. But today we have a couple of good-looking women on the show, and I want them to respond to this one. Women buy, about 15% of pickups. I know Linda's a pickup fanatic. I don't know about Heather, but what do you ladies think about that?
I find that interesting. I live in Montana, so buying pickups is not a gender issue, but I don't know what the answer to that is, if that really is true or not. I don't know. You want to know what I drive, but I'll tell you later.
Thank you. Linda.
Well, I think women buy pickups because women are smart. I just had a Chevy 1500 series Z71 this past week, and I thought to myself, you know, it's really hard to live without a pickup truck. They are just so purposeful. I mean, it's like, okay, I'm cleaning out the rose bushes and I'm trimming the hedges and, you know, I'm loading the stuff up and putting it on the brush pile, but inside it's like a luxury car. It's leather everywhere. I can go anywhere in it. It doesn't get the best fuel economy in the world, but compared to pickup trucks from days of yore, they get phenomenal fuel economy now. This one was showing about 18.2 in regular driving and 22 out on the highway, which when you consider how big these vehicles are and how much tire they have on the ground, they are also very safe vehicles. We can sort of slide into this. There was a little incident involving a pickup truck in your town, Charlotte, this week.
Cam Newton.
Yes, yes. And I don't know if you took a close look at the pictures on the news, but somebody needs to tell him about the roll center of a vehicle. It's really not a good idea to put a vehicle's body about 12 feet above the tires. For anybody that doesn't know what the roll center is, it's where the gravitational force of the weight of the vehicle rotates. And so the higher you have the roll center, the greater the likelihood that you're going to fall on your noggin, which I gather his vehicle rolled up quite a few times, and thankfully he wasn't tremendously injured. He does have some fractures in his back that they say are recoverable. But, you know, pickup trucks for women are, you know, I think they're a natural purchase, especially maybe the Colorado-sized pickup. If people don't want, you know, parking a large truck. Personally, I like all pickups. Mostly I like really big pickups. I love diesel pickups. I love diesel anything. But
Ram just announced the second-in-command is now a lady.
Well, you know, like I said, if women buy pickups because women are smart, and Dodge seems to be pretty smart in the pickup department these days. They're catching a lot of thunder in that segment. And, you know, I can't find any reason for a woman not to buy a pickup, honestly.
And if I remember correctly, what was it, the Challenger or either the Charger event that we were on, one of the main designer was a female. So that was very interesting.
Well, we had a guest on the show, the lady that was in charge of the Challenger. She was a chief engineer. And,
right.
You know, I think that says a lot about where the Chrysler Fiat, you know, group is headed, you know, that they're putting women in places of prominence.
Well, we've had our guests sitting there sweating long enough. I always like to keep them waiting. I like to watch the expressions on their faces as they just sit there. Some of them don't realize that they are being seen. Heather does because she's done these before. Kurt probably doesn't. But anyway, let's move right into a brand new segment. I wanted to do something called Spotlight, where we will take a small business and spotlight that business. And it all started as a result of Small Business Saturday a few Saturdays ago, and I said that'd be nice for us to do, get something that's not, you know, initially related with cars, even though all business people probably drive something. So I decided to have Heather on, mainly because Heather is good on the show. She has a great website. She does some great things with crafts, and she knows how to use this medium, so I don't have to try and train her to do this. Now, Kurt, you watch and listen to Heather, and that's what you're going to have to do next. But she's going to set the bar high for you, buddy.
All right.
Oh, my, that's a little bit of pressure there.
I am tuned in.
From crafts. And, Heather, tell us a little bit about who you are. I know you said you're in Montana. And tell us a little bit about your small business.
All right, I'd love to. Wow, after all of that, I don't know if I have anything to add, but I run and operate an online business. I do hangouts like this where I craft live, kind of like those cooking shows, but through the magic of television, et cetera, et cetera. I have a project completed by the end of an hour, and sometimes it's a little challenging, and sometimes I make huge mistakes, but it's all right there, and then it's recorded, and you can watch it on YouTube if you aren't able to watch live, but I do that, and then I also have a online store that I just opened where I sell not only the things that I make, but also the products that I use in my crafting, and it's all done on the internet, and it's tons of fun. So yeah, I'm in Montana where it snows a lot, but I don't have to go very far because I just commute downstairs, and voila, I'm right here at work.
And those tires will come in handy getting up and down those steps.
Yes, that's right. That's right. Now, Heather, I can't wait to talk to Bridgestone.
Yeah, you can talk to Kurt a little later about your needs out there in Montana. But I did watch one of your shows today. It was the this and that. You had the butterfly, and you were adding all the glitter and all the little things like that to it.
Yeah, that's today's newest segment. That's just started today. You saw that.
Oh, so you're on a new segment, and you can talk about a new segment. How did you get into crafting?
How did I get into crafting? Let's see. I was a preschooler, and we used yarn and oatmeal tubs, and we made stuff with it.
So you taught that in school, or?
No, I was a preschooler.
Oh, okay.
Crafting's been in my blood, I think, since I was born, pretty much.
And the products that you produce, do you intend to sell them in your shop now, or is just to help people to become experienced in crafting?
A little bit of both. I like to share the little things that I learn along the way, especially because when I first started doing all of this live on camera, my purpose was the videos that I was watching on YouTube and those kind of things to learn how to do certain things. I saw how perfect they were, and there was one video I was watching where the gal had shown how to do something, and then within the next couple of frames of that video, she showed the sample, but it was different than it was before. So I knew somewhere in there was a mistake, but rather than...
We have a serious echo from somebody.
Rather than seeing the product go from this step to the step where the mistake was, she had cut that part out of the video. And I went back and looked and looked and looked multiple times to see it, and I went, yep, it's different than it was. And I thought, you know what, that's the problem, because no matter how many times I try to do this, I'm going to end up with that first example and mess it up and not do the second one, the perfect one. And I thought, somebody needs to be doing this for real, not
edited.
The perfect video. Yeah, so that's what I did. And sometimes people like to watch like a train wreck, see me come, you know, dump the stuff all over the floor or spill glitter everywhere or whatever, but sometimes it's a lot of fun when I do that too.
Now, one of my daughters started doing this with jewelry, and she stopped because the cost of the product got to be more than what she could charge a customer.
Yeah, sometimes it is like
that. How does one manage the supply costs?
Well, for me personally, running my own internet store does help because I get a discount, obviously. Also, being able to keep the product in mind, the end result in mind as I'm doing things over the profit margin, really. So if I look at a piece that I want to complete, I think ahead to what it is before it's done. And if I can do that relatively low cost, then I will go for it. And if I can't, then I really better love that project. So that way I do it for the love and not so much for the profit.
Okay. We have some serious echoes in the back. Let's try a couple of you muting yourselves and see if we can get rid of that. Just a mic check.
I think that might have helped.
Was that you, Linda, that echo was coming from? I guess so, for some reason.
It's hard because the person who's echoing never really can tell that it's echoing.
Great. Unmute yourself. Thank you.
Anybody you want to hear my dulcet tone?
I wonder if you were the person that was muting. But anyway, Linda, leave your mic off for a while, and we'll see if that takes care of the echo that's in the background. Folks, I apologize, but this is what happens when you are live, and this is what I like. You can hear how we work through those problems. Just like Heather said, hey, that crafter edited out a piece, and she couldn't figure out how to get that done. That's like somebody telling you directions, and they always leave out that one turn.
so you never get the
way you're supposed to go.
That's right.
Anybody have a quick question for Heather before we move on into tires?
Yeah, well, my question for Heather, obviously, if you live in Montana, do you drive a pickup truck or do you drive a sedan? And what do you, you know, talk to me a little bit about that.
Am I allowed to talk about it now?
Of course you can.
I actually drive a 2001 Chevy Tahoe, which is my rendition of a cross between both.
Okay.
I like that it feels like a pickup. I don't think I could ever drive anything that's lower to the ground ever again.
I'm curious how Roosevelt and Heather got hooked up together. He's in Charlotte and she's in Montana.
It's called the internet. It's called Google Plus. It's called community.
Yep.
If you go on Google Plus on a regular basis, and you can pretty much find a community for any and everything. There are so many people doing hangouts, all kinds of hangouts, good, bad, and indifferent. just so happened that Heather and I know some other people who are on Hangouts, and you can friend people. Well, it's not you don't friend people, but you can join, have them to join the community. And I've seen her on a lot of different shows. We've emailed each other. We participate in business Hangouts is where I really got to know her on a, I guess, a closer basis, because every Friday business Hangouts has pretty much a training and technical session where we can come on and ask questions and sort of sit around just like what we're doing here. And that's how I met Heather, and I said, hey, Heather would be a great person to do the first spotlight. And wouldn't you know it, we have Steve on, we messed up the audio, we have echoing in the background, all the things that we learned in the training that you're supposed to take care of in the green room before you go live with a show. But what can I say?
It's that's perfect for me, because this is the way live show goes to me.
This is how it goes, so yep. That's how we met.
Bruises. Yep.
Anyway, moving right along, and as our special guest for today is Kurt Berger from Bridgestone, and he happens to be the manager for consumer sales and engineering. He's worked in product development, quality, and helping consumers to educate consumers about tires and, I guess, the tire business and products and services. And it's very timely that we're having Kurt on today, because the White House just came out with an announcement or program talking about tires and educating people about tires in the industry, I guess, itself. So, Kurt, you came on the show at a very, very opportune time, and tell us a little bit more about yourself, and let's talk about Bridgestone.
Absolutely. Well, my name's Kurt Berger, and I hail from Music City, Nashville, Tennessee here. I started at Bridgestone almost 27 years ago, and during those 27 years, my first 9 years, I worked in product development and specifically product testing. So I did a lot of on-track testing at different facilities around the world, developed original equipment tires, so I've worked directly with most of the world's primary automobile manufacturers. Also have worked in manufacturing quality for some number of years, and I work in an area called sales engineering, and I manage passenger and light truck tires. And what we really try to focus on is understanding what the real needs of our customers are in the market and communicating that information to our development people. And then conversely, taking all the technical information about our tires and educating the public. So it's really kind of a two-way street. And it's been an exciting career with Bridgestone, because there's a lot of passion here for making cars as good as they possibly can be. I happen to be, I don't know how to phrase it, an automotive nut. I've owned well over 100 cars. I collect cars, European cars primarily, diesel cars, Linda, big fan of diesel cars. And what has really impressed me over the years is how much a tire can change the whole personality of the vehicle and really make it more enjoyable and more safe. And the announcement from the White House that education with regards to tires is very exciting for us. We've actually been very engaged with the government over the years, moving towards this point where we can get more meaningful information out there about tires. So we've worked very closely with NHTSA and other government agencies, and we're really excited about getting more information. There's a lot of conversation out there about rolling resistance and fuel economy. That's going to be incorporated in these new education parameters, as well as safety, traction, and tread wear. And really, they're in the front of all consumers' minds out there on tires.
Well, I have a couple questions, and then we'll let the panelists jump in, including Heather, if she has any questions for Kurt. First one, Kurt, what's the simplest but most difficult thing that owners should know about tire safety? When I say difficult, I mean the most difficult to explain to people about tire safety.
Well, when we talk about tire safety, tires generally do their job so unobtrusively and effectively that tires tend to be out of sight and out of mind. They're underneath our car. They're very reliable. The public generally understands very well that they need that oil changed every 3,000 to 5,000 miles. But the tire tends to get overlooked in terms of its contribution to safety. And if there's one thing I'd like to communicate is that the tire itself has no ability to carry any of the vehicle load in and of itself. The tire is essentially a pressure chamber, and so the inflation pressure inside that container carries 100% of the load. And this is not a real complex message, but in study after study, we've discovered that a significant portion of tires out there running down the road are underinflated. And underinflation, first of all, as an auto enthusiast, you're not going to be able to enjoy that vehicle's handling and ride characteristics. Your tires are not going to wear optimally, and certainly the rolling resistance of that tire is going to go up very significantly if it's underinflated. So this is a message that we, in the tire industry, not just Bridgestone, really spend a lot of time on, having folks get out there at least once a month, check those tires when they're cold first thing in the morning, and you're going to be able to enjoy a greatly enhanced vehicle experience, save money, and also get where you're going with a much less, much lower chance of having problems on the side of the road.
Well, you happen to mention one of the things that just irks me to no, it just chafes my butt when I'm in a car that has a tire pressure monitoring system that does not work. It drives me totally insane. Are you working with car companies that have better systems? If you don't have a good system, don't put it in the car, because it drives me nuts. Then some of them don't tell you which tire is low. I mean, come on, guys. It can't cost that much.
You know, those tire pressure monitoring systems, it surprises a lot of people. The first ones showed up, believe it or not, in the late 1980s. And that technology has literally evolved over decades. And there are two or three different types of technology. One of them involves utilizing the ABS system to trigger a low tire. And also there is a direct system that actually can give you the actual inflation pressure on the dashboard. So there was a 2007 regulation from the government that all new vehicles would have that TPMS system. Some are better than others, but as a tire manufacturer, we very much support those tire pressure monitoring systems. Going back to my original comments, if we can keep those tires inflated at optimum pressure and also give the driver an alert when one of those tires is low, we're going to go a long ways to make the road safer.
Great. Well, if anybody's been on the road, especially the interstate, you see rubber all over the road. I mean, tires, most of them, I guess, are from trucks. final question is there a good and safe retread?
You know, that's a good question. In the truck business, retreads are very, very common. And even a decade ago, there were a lot of questions about that rubber that we see on the side of the road. Sometimes we tend to see it more in the summertime. So the tire industry really took a close look at those rubber pieces. We literally physically collected them and worked with the government and other groups to understand are those retreads, are those original tires, are those tires that have been injured from a road hazard. And what we discovered from that real in-depth study is that the retread tires really didn't statistically comprise a bigger sample relative to the number of tires on the road. A lot of people don't realize for truck tires, that original tire, once it wears out, a quality tire can be retreaded perfectly safe to two and even three times during the course of its life. So, there is that thought that the retread is the tire on the side of the road, but proportionally, the retreads have proven to be just as effective and safe as other tires.
Well, I must apologize to the retread industry because I have been calling them all kinds of names every time I see the rubber on the highway. Please accept my apologies. And thank you for straightening that out, Kurt. That's what I like about this show. We get good information from the people that know. Quick questions for Kurt from anybody.
Kurt, I have a three-part question here. First, let me say that I am a self-admitted tire nerd. I drive down the road looking at people's underinflated tires. I actually tell them when I see them in the parking lot. You know. But would you agree that an underinflated tire builds up extra heat and it's the number one cause of tire failure in tires is underinflation?
Yes.
Okay.
Heat is the enemy of the tire. We want to avoid heat buildup. Absolutely.
I always think of it like trying to drag an underinflated balloon across something. That it, you know, as you pull the balloon, it creates friction, and so an underinflated tire sort of drags across the road surface and builds up heat.
You're absolutely right.
The other thing is, do you think that underinflation is the number one cause of hydroplaning in most instances? Because the water pressure is greater than the air pressure and takes the tread off the road surface.
There are a lot of contributors to hydroplaning. When we think about hydroplaning, we're talking about the tire's ability simply to evacuate water on the road surface as it's rotating. And the tire evacuates that water through the grooves and the sipes in the tread. So water evacuation primarily is related to the pattern design of the tire. The inflation may be a contributor, certainly to get the optimum performance. We also want to maintain an appropriate contact patch. And the shape of that contact patch is directly related to the inflation pressure. So you're absolutely right. It is a contributor, but there's a whole host of other contributors that prevent hydroplaning.
And there was a lot of jokes made back in the political arena a few years ago about saying that, checking your air pressures would increase your fuel economy. Now, I don't think that's a joke. I think a properly inflated tire actually contributes to the maximum fuel economy. What is Bridgestone's thoughts on that?
Well, when we think about where the energy is lost when you fuel a vehicle, the tires contribute somewhere between 5% and 8% to those energy loss. The most energy loss is in the driveline through friction and heat. Exhaust heat dissipation. But I'll use a simple example. if you're on a bicycle that's designed to have 90 pounds per square inch of pressure, and you drop that to 30, how much harder do you think you're going to have to pedal to keep that bicycle going down the road? We actually used that in a demonstration event. In order for the tire to be able to maintain traction and also cushion the occupants of the vehicle, it has to actually deform and really grip the road. So if that deformation is too much, it generates heat. So that inflation pressure is going to prevent that tire from deforming so much as it rotates. We've all seen a half-flat tire going down the road, and that creates drag, and that robs us of those precious gallons of fuel that we buy to put in our vehicle.
Can you think of any single accessory that you can put on a vehicle that does more to enhance and show off its handling characteristics than the original OEM tire that the sports car designer had developed for their car, or for someone that's looking to make an aftermarket car handle better? Is there a cheaper thing you can do than buying a good set of shoes for it?
I think I get excited because you can take a vehicle that is a rather ordinary mainstream vehicle, and with the proper tires, you can totally change the way that vehicle grips, handles, and gives the driver confidence. So I would agree with you. Obviously, there's a number of things that can be done to tune a vehicle, with the suspension, drivetrain, but the tire is probably the cheapest and quickest way for anyone to achieve whatever goal they have. You mentioned handling. Some customers may put more of an emphasis on the car being the quietest it can be, or having the best traction in snow. So really, the tire maker, it's about offering a range of options out there that optimize the tire performance for what the customer's looking for. And if he's looking for handling, certainly you can very effectively do that with the tire.
Thank you.
Kurt, I have a question. This is more of a dollar to cents issue. We see a lot of new cars come up with great mileage ratings, 38, 39, 40, 41 miles to the gallon, and much of it is predicated on OEM spec tires, usually low resistance, low rolling tires. But on the other side of it, these aren't necessarily the best pieces of rubbers to have on your car in inclement weather in places like Montana where heather is. What's the balancing act if you've got to either upgrade or change your tires to deal with a different kind of road surface and driving situation than originally envisioned by the OEM?
That's a great question. And historically, when we reduce rolling resistance, it can have a significant impact on other attributes, for example, tread wear or traction. And one of the things we get excited about is technology, new technology, that enables us to really lower that rolling resistance while maintaining the other attributes the tire has to do, the comfort, the tread wear, the snow traction, the dry traction. That automobile manufacturer has a long list of goals that they have to achieve. One of those is fuel economy. And really, that tire from the factory is optimized for what that automobile manufacturer believes that their customer wants out of that vehicle. Now, we here today know that there's every type of enthusiast, and people live in different locations. For that vehicle owner in Montana or Michigan, when fall comes, they're thinking about getting around in those snowstorms. And so as a tire manufacturer, again, it's about being able to provide tires that optimize the specific needs for every user. And those needs are different. We are focusing on rolling resistance reduction on all of our product lines, winter, performance, summer tires, all season tires. So we're integrating that technology across the board. But obviously, tire engineering is about compromise, and it's about finding and identifying where to optimize that performance in each particular category of tire.
You said some things there, Kurt, that I wanted to ask, if you don't mind, Greg. I have a question about Sipe tires versus tires with studs. We had the best tires ever, and they were Siped, but then, of course, my husband says that they're not good for us. So I'm not sure if I tell him he's right or what. So you let me know.
Sure. I'd love to answer that question. If we think about tire siping, and just to clarify, siping is simply a cut in the tread, part of the tread pattern. If we think of a racing slick, it has no grooves, no sipes, it's perfectly smooth, and of course that's for use on a dry road only. Tires only have grooves and sipes because of the need for wet performance and snow performance. So when we go from that dry tire, that tire that wouldn't have any tread pattern at all, then to the other end of the spectrum, which would be a winter tire, you're going to see the winter tire has a lot of grooves, a lot of sipes, a lot of cuts in the tread area. Those cuts actually create a biting edge to get grip in the snow. So the tires that Bridgestone sells, our Blizzak product line, you'll notice on the store shelf that they have a lot of sipes in them. Siping is something that's quite common in northern areas of the country to add additional sipes. We generally don't recommend it because we have developed that tire to be optimized for winter performance and also taking into all those other characteristics. We want that winter tire to wear well. We want it to be quiet. We want it to be comfortable. And one of the things we have to keep in mind that even in the northern areas, the roads are dry quite often through the winter. So when we add additional sipes that aren't there from the factory, that could actually negatively affect the handling. So from the factory, winter tires have adequate siping, and the siping is very critical for the winter performance.
So does Bridgestone carry a winter line that is one that you would recommend for a Montana girl?
We have a line of tires called Blizzak. I think most of you probably have heard of Blizzak. And it's a wide range of tires that fit a wide range of vehicles. I'm hearing a lot of folks that are into pickup trucks. We have a light truck line of Blizzaks, the DMV1, DMV2, and then passenger and CUV Blizzaks. All these vehicles have different characteristics. So we were talking a little bit earlier about center gravity. We actually design tires to be compatible with vehicles with different levels of center of gravity. So the short answer, absolutely, and we're very proud of our Blizzak product line. It's sold throughout the world.
Well, just to let you know, we'll be buying snow tires next week, so I'll be looking for those.
be happy to talk to you.
I had a question about tires.
You had a question? Greg.
Yeah, I did have one question, and this is sort of off topic, but Kurt, you talked about winter tires. One of my concerns is in urban centers, I see a lot of young guys with 22, 24 inch wheels and these very low profile tires on these cars that were built back in the 80s and so forth. Talk to us a little bit about the safety of that kind of tire on a car that was designed for a 15 inch wheel.
That's a great question, and Having worked very closely with a lot of automobile manufacturers, I remember the heady heydays of low riders. I lived in Los Angeles for about 10 years. In the 90s, seeing the brand new 7 Series from the factory that's been poured over by engineers with the proper tire wheel package, and then we see a set of 20s or 21s on that vehicle. And you're absolutely right. When a vehicle comes from the factory, it's been very carefully scrutinized for handling, for ride. And any time you change the diameter of the vehicle, of the tire wheel assembly, or any other attribute, you can pretty dramatically affect the handling, the ride characteristics, and ultimately the safety. We actually have a website, tiresafety.com, that walks through step-by-step how you can make those tire upgrades to a larger wheel and tire safely. It can be done safely, and it can be done without having a real negative impact on the vehicle performance. But you're absolutely right. There's a lot of folks that are doing it and not really with all the information they need to make the right decision.
And
go ahead, Greg.
I mentioned an issue about studded tires. Are they still made at all?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear your what kind of tire?
Studded tires. You remember those where you had little pieces of metal sticking out the tire?
Absolutely.
Make those?
Absolutely. Studded tires are still made. They comprise a very, very small part of the market. And really, the studless tire that has emerged in the last 10 to 15 years has really taken over that market. I think anyone that's used studded tires knows all the disadvantages of studded tires. They're noisy. They do damage to the roads. And Bridgestone has focused on developing Blizzak line of tires to give equal or better ice and winter performance to the old studded tire without using studs. And there's a lot of very interesting technology that we have with the tread rubber compounds and patterns that we've used that really makes the studded tire obsolete, frankly speaking. But there are a few of them that still remain out there in the market.
Kurt, as you know, we've had some severe weather, from rainy storms to some unbelievable ice storms. And in a lot of areas, I know when I lived in Indiana, they were always talking about putting chains on tires. What do chains do to the new tires that are out there on the road today?
Well, we talked a little bit about biting edges and trying to get as many biting edges in the tire that we can. And obviously that chain is adding a very aggressive biting edge. If a chain is properly designed, properly installed, and in some areas, mountain areas, they're actually required. If they're properly installed and only remain on the vehicle when it's completely necessary, generally they won't cause a problem for the tire. But again, as a tire manufacturer, we're really focusing on technologies that give the ice traction levels and snow traction levels to really alleviate the need for studs or chains or any other kind of aftermarket technology to get snow traction.
Now, Kurt, the wear pattern on tires probably tell you a lot about some of the things that could be going wrong with your vehicle or the tire itself, like underinflation and alignment. Is this something that when you take a car into a dealership, say, for a regular check, that the service person that's there, do they look at that and look at the wear pattern and try to help the consumer in that area as to things that they shouldn't be doing or should be doing?
That's a good question. Bridgestone, very much focused in on awareness of the tire condition. One of the things we want to let people know is that as part of that monthly inflation pressure check, we recommend that not only tires be inspected by professionals, but we recommend that the user themselves look at the tires and just look for anything unusual, cuts, abrasion, really abnormal wear in the tread area. If you're unsure of what to look for, our Firestone Complete Auto Cares, and there are some 2,000 of them across the country, they will inspect your tires for free and check the inflation pressure for free. And you're absolutely right. If you look at the tire will literally tell you or tell a professional what might be going with it and on with it in terms of irregular wear. There may be an alignment setting that's out. There may be some suspension parts that are worn. So it's really critical that the customers have their tires inspected regularly, not only for safety, but also so they can save money and have that tire run through its normal service life.
I've got an old station wagon sitting in the driveway that I only drive once or twice a month. One of the things I'm very concerned about is tire rot, because it literally sits there for long periods of time. Is that a serious issue to be concerned with, or is there anything that a consumer like myself who only uses the car to run to Home Depot or get firewood, anything we should be doing?
Absolutely. Tires that are exposed, that sit outside, are exposed to a lot of ultraviolet radiation, and that can break down the tires, and tires actually have chemicals in them to prevent them from oxidizing, and those chemicals leave the tire over time. If you're unsure as to whether any cracking on the tire really is going to affect the structural integrity, we would recommend having them inspected by a tire center to determine whether they should be removed from service. Some level of cracking over time, minor cracking, can be purely cosmetic. So really it's important to get the tires looked at to determine whether it's cosmetic or something that you should consider replacing.
Kurt, are there any myths about tires in the industry that just drive you crazy?
That's a great question. You know, I go back to tire technology. There is a perception that tires, since they are black and round, and they kind of look like they did 50 or 60 or even 80 years ago, that a tire is a very low-tech piece of equipment. There's a perception sometimes that rubber is just poured into a mold in a factory and out comes a tire. If you dissect a tire and look at the components, the materials, the technology inside that tire, it is incredibly complex to be able to do what the tire does on a daily basis with all of the road objects, the weather, you mentioned the sun, the ozone, all that a tire has to do safely and competently. There's little recognition of the really exciting technology that goes into the tire to make it do it, conduct its mission quietly and unobtrusively. So it does frustrate us, and that's why we spend a lot of time educating the public and on tire safety and technology.
Any final questions for Kurt?
Can you hear me, Roosevelt? I don't think you can hear me.
I have one quick one. What does the White House new initiative do for your industry? It's frozen.
It's not that cold in Nashville.
Kurt, what's the, did you hear me?
I can hear you.
Oh, I was asking, what does the White House new initiative, what does that do to your industry?
Well, again, we've been working with the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration for a number of years now on this initiative that was just announced by the White House administration. There are really three primary areas for this new initiative, which is called the Consumer Tire Information Act. And they deal with measuring and giving the consumer information about tread wear, about traction, which relates to safety, and then the new information on rolling resistance and fuel economy. Obviously, as a tire industry, we've been focused on tread wear, traction and safety, and rolling resistance for decades. In fact, since the late 1970s, early 80s, in some of the fuel crises back in that time, we've been focusing on rolling resistance now for more than 30 years. So these current activities are really a continuation of activities that we've been involved with for years. But we welcome and are thoroughly engaged in this conversation about how we can better educate the public so they can make informed decisions when they buy tires.
Great. Heather, Kurt, want to thank both of you for obviously taking time out of your busy schedules to come on this show here talking about crafts, which have nothing to do with cars, unless Heather is going to start making some car crafts that can be sold to the auto industry, and Kurt on talking about tires, and which is always interesting. But I appreciate both of you taking the time. You're welcome to come back at any time and update us on what you're doing. And we're going to jump now into a segment that we call First Thoughts. And if I can get the screen share to work like it's supposed to work, since I haven't done it last time, I tried something different. And let's see here. Here we go. Well, I thought we were going.
I see something.
Yeah, I see something too. There we go. Is that it?
Yeah.
This is a 2015 Volkswagen Jetta TDI SE with connectivity. It's a 2-liter clean diesel 4-cylinder. Delivers 150 horsepower, has a 6-speed manual transmission. Exterior color is a reflex silver metallic. The interior is a Titan black leatherette. Gets 31 miles per gallon in the city, 45 on the highway, 36 combined. What happened to it? It stopped. First thoughts.
I've had a chance to drive this car, and I like it for what it does. The TDI diesel at 45 to the gallon and on the highway, and it delivers that, as I've learned driving from here to Clarksville, Tennessee, Kurt, going right by your front door.
Yes.
It's got enough torque for the hills coming over the mountains, and I was very impressed with it, and considering I had 4 adults in the vehicle, with luggage, I was very impressed with it. My only knock on it, and this is a personal thing, is we had a blowout, and changing the tire was not my most fun thing to do, getting everyone's luggage out. But, you know, for the most part, I like the car. I think Volkswagen does what it does well. If you want fancy interior, this ain't the car for you, because everything is black, it's monochromatic, but you want something that's functional, it'll get you from point A to point B, and with phenomenal fuel economy, this nails it, and you'll drive this car forever and ever and ever and ever.
Heather?
My first thoughts are it's too low to the ground. Looks cute, though.
Linda, you're back. Did you hear what we were looking at here?
I just caught the tail end of it. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, it's a 2015 Volkswagen Jetta TDI SE. First thoughts?
Well, first off, it's a diesel, so that means I love it. Okay. Second off, it gets 41 miles per gallon. That means I love it. Volkswagens are, as Greg pointed out, not known for their soft and cushy interiors, but they're very utilitarian vehicles. They build a fine product. I think this is an attractive package, and I'd put it on any shopping list for a new vehicle.
Kurt?
I happen to own a 2014 Reflex Silver Jetta TDI with a 6-speed manual. So
what are the chances?
I'm not going to provide the most objective input on this. I've owned more than 20 diesel automobiles, and you know, I had a 1999 Volkswagen Jetta with about 350,000 miles on the original engine and clutch. The durability certainly is there. And one of the things we need to remember about the diesel technology is in this car we have 236 foot-pounds of torque that are ready and available at 1,600 RPM. And that really delivers a totally different driving experience, particularly if you're in town and you do a lot of stoplight to stoplight driving. The response level is fantastic, and for those that are used to the old noisy and smoky diesel cars, and I own those too from the 80s and 70s, the noise levels are very similar to a gasoline car. My only concern right now is there's about $1 or $1.25 difference between gasoline and diesel, that really has to be factored into the buying decisions.
Well, this car, from a design standpoint, does not impress me. Like Greg said, it's very, very utilitarian. Like everyone else, I like the diesel. This one was a little noisier than I anticipated. I enjoy driving the 6-speed manual transmission. The interior of the car is very comfortable. Exterior looks doesn't excite me. Price point obviously is pretty good, $24,000 for this particular car. I didn't give you that. It's $24,895. And like Kurt was saying, there is a big difference now between diesel and gasoline price, so you have to take that into consideration. But overall, this Jetta SE and the connectivity means you can plug in different devices on this car to get you on the internet and anything else you want to do. But overall, it's very utilitarian, basic transportation. And I must say, this is the first show that we've done where the featured guest, I pulled up the first thoughts car is one that they own. This was not planned. And the first time we do a spotlight business, the spotlight business owner drives or purchases the product that the featured guest is talking about. Now, does this look like or sound like it's staged?
Couldn't get any better if we tried.
We could. You're right, Greg. We tried hard to get Kurt on the show because it took a couple of days to get the technology worked out. But I couldn't believe it when Heather told me, oh, I drive Bridgestone tires. I said, well, maybe I can get Kurt to send you a coupon so you can buy some. Maybe you two can. I'll try and hook that up for you, for you, Heather. But anyway, we'll this is Roosevelt with Auto Network. Hey, I enjoyed this show, even though we had some technical issues. That's what makes it exciting. Folks, you know that it's live. It's not planned. It's not staged. We gave you some great information. You should watch this tire segment over and over again to make sure that you stay safe out there on the road. And as always, I want to thank all of you for taking your time to be on the show again. Come back anytime. I know Greg will be back next week. But please, folks, buckle up. Don't drink and drive. See you next time.
Take care, folks.
Bye, all.